Jesus' name. For the people that do like Belshazzar, and you see other people pray, and you see their daddy Nebuchadnezzar praying and saying, I extol God, I praise God, I humble myself in the sight of God, and then the sins of Nebuchadnezzar, everything was washed away, and then like Belshazzar, they say, I don't care for that, I'm not going to pray for that, I'm going to be a man, a woman, a lady, a boy, a girl of myself, and then your sin remains, and then eventually you have nobody to blame when you die in that sin, and then you are judged for that iniquity you have done. But the opportunity is there today that we can call upon the name of the Lord. And it says, He blots out, He cleanses all, He takes away the handwriting of ordinances that was against us, which was contrary to us, and He took it out of the way. He'll take your sin out of the way, nailing it to His cross. And when that happens, God says, I'll not remember your sin against you anymore. They are forgiven and they are forgotten forever in Jesus' name. I need a good headquarters. Say amen. Amen. Hebrews chapter 10, I'm reading from verse 17. When your sins are washed away, when your sins are taken away, when the blood of Jesus Christ, His only begotten Son, when He cleanses, washes, purges, blots everything away. Hebrews chapter 10 verse 17, and their sins and their iniquities will I remember no more, not remembered again, because of the mercy of the Lord, and that mercy is available for every one of us. Whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. We come to point number three now, the soothsayer's failure, the soothsayer's failure, and the perplexity of the guilty. We're coming to Daniel chapter 5, and we're reading from verse 7. Daniel chapter 5, reading from verse 7. And the king cried aloud to bring the astrologers and the Chaldeans and the soothsayers, and the king spake and said to the wise men of Babylon, whosoever shall read this writing and show me the interpretation thereof shall be clothed with scarlet and have a chain of gold about his neck, and shall be the third ruler in the kingdom. Then came all the king's wise men, but they could not read the writing to make known to the king of the interpretation thereof. And then the king Belshazzar was greatly troubled, and his countenance was changed in him, and his lords were astonished. Here we find the failure of these stargazers, the failure of the soothsayers, the failure of the people that were professing to have the power, the knowledge, the insight, the revelation of the Almighty, but they fell flat. We're looking at Isaiah chapter 44 verse 25. Isaiah chapter 44. And here we read in verse 25. Verse 25 says that frustrated the tokens of the liars and maketh diviners mad, that turneth the wise men backward and maketh their knowledge foolish. The knowledge that Belshazzar thought they had, the Lord made that foolish. They could not interpret. What an unfortunate thing here, like father, like son. Belshazzar foresaw the help of the astrologers, the Chaldeans, and the soothsayers, just like Nebuchadnezzar did repeatedly in his days of darkness, superstition, and ignorance. They always failed to understand or to interpret God's message from heaven. But these earthbound kings always sought after them. They always sought help where there is no help. Seeking help where there is no help. How many people are still doing that today in our world? They have a little problem, or they have a big problem, a major problem, and they're seeking help from man where there is no help. Jeremiah chapter 17. In Jeremiah chapter 17, I'm reading from verse 5. Jeremiah 17 verse 5. Actually, there's judgment on people like that. Those who seek after soothsayers, Those who are looking for hidden knowledge from a cult or from occultism. Those who are seeking from the superstition and the power of Satan, and they're seeking some things from those who say there's judgment on them. In Jeremiah chapter 17, verse 5, thus says the Lord, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, whose heart departeth from the Lord. Have you noticed some people, as the promises of God are there? We can easily claim those promises, but no, their minds are not in God's promises. Their hearts are not in the promises of God. And when they're looking for either guidance, or they're looking for direction, or they're looking for where to go or what to do, they're not looking at God, and they're not seeking the face of the Lord. They're seeking after man. And it says, cursed be the man that trusteth in man and maketh flesh his arm, his support, his power, his sustenance. And then it says, and whose heart departeth from the Lord. You think about yourself. When you have a particular need in your life, what's the first person you think about? Do you think about God? About Christ? About the promises of God? Do you think about faith? And you think about prayer? When you have a challenge in your life, what's the first thing you do? You do like Nebuchadnezzar or Belshazzar, as if you never had any promise of God in your life. Cursed be the man that trusteth in man and makes the arm of the flesh his own strength and support, whose heart departs from the Lord. In verse 6, for he shall be like the heath in the desert, and shall not see when good cometh, but shall inhabit the parched places in the wilderness, in a salt land and not inhabited. We'll trust the Lord. I said we'll trust the Lord, because it says in verse 7, blessed is the man that trusteth in the Lord, whose hope the Lord is, for he shall be as a tree planted by the waters, and that spreadeth out her roots by the river, and shall not see when heat cometh, but her leaves shall be green, and shall not be careful in the year of drought, neither cease from yielding fruit. Psalm 146. Remember what Belshazzar did when he had that challenge. He called for the soothsayers. He called for those magicians and Chaldeans and the worldly wise men of Babylon. Instead of calling upon God, his father knew God. Daniel was there. Daniel knew God. And they made Daniel the last resort when it was too late. We're looking at Psalm 146, verse 3. Put not your trust in princes, nor in the son of man, in whom there is what? No hell. And you see many people, they'll be going and coming. They'll go, uncle, how about it? Come again. Uncle, how about it now? Come again. Cousin, how about you now? Come again. Because you think they are princes. They have long leg. They have contacts. They can do this, they can do that. Instead of praying, instead of looking up to the Lord, it says, put not your trust in princes, nor in the son of man, in whom there is no help. His breath goeth forth, he turneth to his earth. In that very day his thoughts perish. Happy is he that has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord his God. The Lord is telling us then, this is what you do. He's telling us, don't put your trust in all those people. Well, let me say a word about those soothsayers before I pass on. Because you see, there are many people, they still put their trust in soothsayers. Who is a soothsayer? Let me show you. Joshua chapter 13, you'll find an example of a soothsayer. And then if you're going to search people, they see vision, they tell prophecy, they interpret dreams, they go into trance, and they say, I was praying, I didn't even close my eyes, I saw trance. And then I saw something about your husband, I saw something about your wife, Who is this by the name of such and such? Is that your senior sister? Go and tell her I saw something about her. And then you are rushing and rushing and rushing there. You are following after the soothsayer. And there's judgment on the soothsayer and judgment on the people that are following after the soothsayers. Those who are consulting. The soothsayers, Joshua chapter 13, I'm reading from verse 22. Joshua chapter 13, verse 22. Balaam also, the son of Beor, the soothsayer. You see that? You see that? Balaam, it was regarded as a soothsayer. Trance, vision, revelation. And you know his way was purpose before the Lord. Was a backslider, still see vision. Living in sin, rebellion, still seeing vision, and doing evil, still seeing vision, counseling Balak to give the daughters of Moab unto the children of Israel that they'll commit sin with them, and still seeing vision. And Jesus said in Revelation chapter 2, the doctrine, the teaching, the advice, the counseling of Balaam, which I hate. He was into what God hated, and he still kept on seeing vision. Those are the soothsayers. Balaam also, the son of Baal, the soothsayer, did the children of Israel slay with the sword among them that was slain by them. I will not follow after a soothsayer. I said we will not follow after a soothsayer. Isaiah chapter 2 verse 6. Isaiah chapter 2 verse 6. Therefore thou hast forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob, because they be replenished from the east, and are soothsayers like the Philistines. They are soothsayers like the Philistines. You know what? Some people go to learn how the prophets of Baal, how the witches in the world, how the sorcerers in the world, how the people having familiar spirits in the world, how they see their vision, how they're able to tell the future, how they're able to do this and do that. And maybe they even wash their face with water or whatever. And it says they're soothsayers like the Philistines. And God is against it. And God said, thou hast forsaken thy people. And the word of God says, thou hast forsaken thy people, the house of Jacob. Why? Because they became soothsayers like the Philistines. You know, those who are soothsayers, sometimes they tell the truth, they tell the kind of truth. And say, but you know, if they are soothsayers, if they are not following after the Lord, how is it they are still telling the truth? Have you ever noticed sometimes your wall clock is dead and your wall clock died at 4:45? The battery is run down and it's not working again. And it happens to be that when you looked up, it was exactly 4:45. And the dead clock is correct at that time. And then you sleep, you wake up early in the morning, you say, should I wake up now? Is this 6 o'clock yet? Then you look up, it's 4:45. The thing is just there because it's dead, and yet it's dead and correct. You know, those associates, they are correct once in a while. And that doesn't mean they are following after the Lord. I will not follow associates. Look at Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. Acts of the Apostles chapter 16. I'm looking at verse 16. And it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with what? A spirit of divination. This evil spirit. This is familiar spirit. This is not Holy Ghost. Acts 16:16. It came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel possessed with a spirit of divination met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The soothsayers are the people involved, the soothsayers. And the same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God. Is that correct or not? It's correct. Soothsayers can be correct once in a while. That doesn't mean you'll follow them. That doesn't mean you'll be seeking vision and direction and counseling from them. These men are the servants of the Most High God, which show us the way of salvation. And there she did many days, but Paul being what? Greek. You know, Paul the apostle knew. He knew that this is so saying. Even though the information appears correct, all the same was grieved, and he turned and said to the Spirit, I command thee in the name of Jesus Christ to come out of her. And he came out the same hour. That's the reason why we are not going to follow them. In the case of Belshazzar, he called these people and he said, help me, interpret this for me. Were they able to help? No, they were not able to help. And that's why we're not going to follow something that is not going to help. We're going to keep on following the Lord in Jesus' name. Job chapter 18. Job chapter 18. We're looking at verse 11. Job 18, reading from verse 11. Terrors shall take him, shall make him afraid on every side. That's what happened to Belshazzar. Even though he called the soothsayers and the astrologers and the stargazers and the Chaldeans and the wise men all the same, they were not able to help. Terrors shall make him afraid on every side and shall drive him, to his feet. And then it says, the strength shall be hunger beating, and the destruction shall be ready at his side. It shall devour the strength of his skin. Even the firstborn of death shall devour his strength. His confidence shall be rooted out of his tabernacle, and it shall bring him to the king's terrors. It shall dwell in his tabernacle, because it is none of his. Brimstone shall be scattered upon his habitation. His roots shall be dried up beneath, and above shall his branch be cut off. His remembrance shall perish from the earth, and he shall have no name in the street. He shall be driven from the light into darkness and chased out of the world. That's exactly what happened to Belshazzar. It will not happen to me. I said it will not happen to you. Because he didn't follow the way of the Lord. We will follow the way of the Lord. The writing that was written against him, he didn't know how those sins can be wiped out. But today we know anything that is written against you, we still have the opportunity and the grace of God. We can call upon the name of the Lord, all your sins will be forgiven. All the iniquities will be taken away, and the guilt and the condemnation will be wiped away with the blood of Jesus Christ. Can we do that tonight? I say, can we do that tonight? Why don't you rise up and tell the Lord, everything that is written against you, every judgment, every condemnation, because of the sins you have committed, and because of the backsliding that has taken place, you want to tell the Lord, oh Lord, you are a God of mercy, you are a God of love, and you are a God that sent Jesus Christ, your only begotten Son, to take away my sin. I believe the Lord tonight. I trust in the Lord tonight. I'm rejoicing in the fact that the blood of Jesus Christ is still mighty and powerful. And the blood of Jesus Christ will take away, will wash away all my sin. If you will tell the Lord like that, he will forgive you. He will take away your sin. He will purge you, will cleanse you. And the Lord will be so wonderful to you. And then he says, I will remember your sin, your iniquity, no more. No more forever. Even Satan will not be able to find that sin. Demons will not be able to find that sin. In the record of God, everything will be wiped away. Why don't you just tell the Lord, oh Lord, here am I. I'm sorry for what I've done. I feel the guilt. I feel the condemnation, oh Lord, but I remember your promise. You have said, whosoever shall call on the name of the Lord shall be saved. Don't you remember when the prodigal son came back home and the prodigal son said, Father, I'm not worthy to be called your child. The father just forgave. The father just washed away all those iniquities and transgressions. And the father never mentioned it to kind of torment him anymore in his life. That's what the Lord will do to you also. That writing against you, that brings condemnation, that brings damnation, that brings guilt, the Lord will wipe everything away. Just say, Lord, here am I. I thank you for Jesus. He is my Savior. He is my Lord. I trust his name. I trust in the efficacy of the blood of the Lamb.